Amen. Good afternoon, champions. What a privilege to be here. God is just moving in our midst. Amen. I love the lyrics to one of those songs is, "You're the reason why we came. You're the reason why we're here." You know, sometimes it's so easy to forget why we're even here. You know, and I'm so thankful that, you know, we have a worship team and, you know, a family of God that loves to press in to, you know, encounter God in a new way each time. Amen. And so what a powerful time that we had. And I know that God is already stirring something inside your spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I know that God is just so in this place. I was even, when we were worshiping, I was praying. I knew that the Lord was, the Holy Spirit was already up to something. I know it's amazing that we give room, you know, as a church, we give room. You know, you're not saying, oh, the worship is so long today. You know, I have this and this and this after. Hurry up, hurry up. How come they sang the bridge again? You know? Because maybe the Lord is waiting for our heart to finally get it. And, you know, I'm encouraged that God doesn't give up on us. He wants to, he gives us more and more chances, more and more choruses until our heart would be softened to hear his voice for ourselves. Amen. And so, you know, what a powerful time. I'm excited to share the word of God to you this afternoon. Of course, you know, greetings from my parents. I always love to give greetings for my parents. They're in Calgary. Continue to pray for them. I know that they probably finished already, but I know that they're 2 hours behind, so they're probably already done their service, but they were there because they did their soul camp, so they were just a week later because they waited for PJ, Pastor Jerry and Mommy E, to go and be with them, so they're there now, and continuing to encourage them in the faith, and so keep praying for them, you know, pray for their strength, pray that God would continue to use them and keep them safe even in their travels. And so God is really doing such a great work in the church. I know you saw a preview of that in our little SoCan video. So continue to pray for them in all that God is doing there with even their L5 and their leadership there. All right. And this afternoon, I want to talk to you. And I know that throughout this entire year, from the very beginning of the year, we've been talking about advance. Right? Advancing. And I'm excited to share a message with you that would continue to advance us forward in the things of God. And so we're going to look already and go straight to the Word of God. And we're going to look into James, the book of James, and starting with verse chapter 1. And we're going to look at verses 22 to 25. And this is what the Word of God says. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like some mirror, and after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Let's just pray. Father God, we thank you for the truth of your word today. Lord, we pray that, Lord, not only will we be hearers of your word, but doers of your word. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would begin to speak to us in a new way. Bring illumination, bring a rhema word to us in this time that we can grab hold of it and that would begin to transform us into your image. Lord, we pray that you would soften every heart, that you would make this relevant to each and every person in whatever way that you need to encounter them in their lives. Holy God, we say that you're worthy of our attention, you're worthy of our focus, you're worthy of our time today. And so, God, we want to hear your voice speak to us. Let you alone have the glory, let you alone have the praise. Let you have the stage today. Jesus, my name we pray. Amen. So we're looking into the book of James today, and just a little bit of background for you. When looking at the book of James, oftentimes it's admired for its practical wisdom. It discusses similar themes that are popular in wisdom literature, so themes that you would probably see in wisdom literature, such as the book of Proverbs. Themes such as single-minded devotion towards God, testing and discipline, talking about speech and even power, communal interaction, self-discipline, and even wickedness and righteousness in relation to wisdom and folly. So as you study the book of James even more intently, it's a little bit of a shorter one, so you could probably read it in a one sitting. It's a shorter book, but you'll be able to see, you know, though it's often, you know, it looks, or though it's prized or cherished many times as a book of practical wisdom, like you can maybe see the book and think like, wow, this is pretty practical. When you read some of the instructions, okay, that makes sense. I can do that one, or it seems really like I can really apply it right away. Though it's you know, very practical for us and is some of the wisdom that is practical, it's amazing when you study the book of James, you can actually, there's many scriptures or many parallels that can be made to what Jesus actually said himself. So I don't have it up here today, but if you study it, you'll find that many of the things that Jesus said himself, it's the exact same things, many of the themes or the things he's calling us to do, it's what Jesus was calling us to do. And so looking at the book of James, we can see that there's really an importance that, you know, Jesus himself said these things. They're not just a checklist of, okay, this is a to-do list. You know, that seems like a good idea. But Jesus himself was saying these things if you really study it. And it's just a calling for us to really practice the word. So in our scripture for today, we look at the main emphasis of this scripture is about hearing versus doing. Right? About hearing versus doing. The Bible makes a comparison in this particular scripture that there between those who are simply hearers and those who are doers of God's word. So this scripture is basically exhorting us that we are to not just hear the word, but we're to do it. We're going to look into another translation, and it's the NASB translation, and we're going to pull it up, and it's in James, again, our main text, James 1, 22 to 25. We're going to read it in a different translation. This is what the Bible says, the NASB version. Okay, but prove yourself, I think it's cut off in the beginning, but prove yourselves doers of the word, not merely hearers who delude themselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in the mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does. See, friends, when we're comparing doing versus hearing, this other translation talks about how we're the people who are doers of who do God's word are equivalent to being a doer. So they're a doer, or if you hear God's word, you're a hearer of God's word. I like what this translation says, because even if you look at the word prove yourselves to become a doer, the prove there is actually a becoming. So it's a becoming, and it's a transitioning from one point to another, where you're essentially this command to do is not just an action step, but it's a becoming. To become a doer. So it's part what you do. So before I go on any further, I want to, I've actually titled this message, Doing Christianity. And before I go on, I do want to let you know that the context or the heart behind this message is not to tell you that you're going to, you need to do a list of things before you earn salvation. That's not what I'm talking about. You know, there's not this list of things that you have to do just to accomplish, you know, before God will save you, that you have to do all these steps and then God will be okay with you. as we know what the Word of God says, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Right? So it's not what we have to do to achieve, you know, our salvation. In fact, we are already, at when we receive Jesus by faith, through, because of his grace, through our faith, then we receive him. Amen? And so I'm not talking about this, you know, a doing where it's a sense of, okay, we got to do this list of things. But I'm talking about the, you know, the being that calls us to do. There's a becoming that God calls us to do where we actually become a doer of God's word. And so being a doer essentially is that is not just, you know, many times we call this, we say we're not a you, it's not what you do, but it's who you are, right? Many times you've heard it's not just what you do, but it's really who you are. So it's about your being. But, you know, we even say many times, oh, you're not a human doing, you're a human being. But in contrast to that, actually God calls us to become, so to be, a doer. Does that make sense? So you're not just doing for the sake of doing all these actions, but God calls us that it becomes part of us that we do his work. Okay, so that's becoming a doer. And the text, you know, it actually has the emphasis is the Greek present imperative, meaning that it's a command and for ongoing action. So God actually calls us that we become a doer ongoing. That is a command, it's not a suggestion. It's a command for us, and it's an imperative thing that God says, yes, we must become a doer of God's word, and it must be a lifestyle. So that the Greek present imperative, it calls for an ongoing lifestyle that becomes a regular long-term way of life. So it's not just meant to be, okay, I'm going to become a doer of God's word, that it's a one-time checklist, I obeyed that, and then that's it. The becoming a doer is it actually, the present imperative means that it's now we're commanded to continue to do, to continue to become a doer of God's word, and it's a long-term way of life, a lifestyle of doing God's word. It's who we are because we're children of God, amen? And so in contrast, that's basically a doer. In contrast, the Bible is talking about not only a doer, but a hearer. And when we look at the original language in this, the what it talks about being a hearer is almost like someone who is in an auditorium to audit a class. That's kind of like the tone of this. When it's talking about a hearer, it's like that definition, it's like a hearer is a person, is almost like a person who is coming into a class who is auditing the class, where they're suggesting that it's mildly tuning in or not fully committed to practicing whatever's going on or what is heard. So that's what a hearer is described in this context. How many of you have ever heard of, maybe it was a university course, it might have been a course that you have to take for your professional life, your career, or school, and or it could have even been a Bible class, and you know that there's sometimes options to audit a course, right? There's an option to audit a course versus to actually be fully registered in the course. I know there was one time where one of my friends, she was wanting to take her MBA, and she was seeking if she can just audit the course because she was saying, oh, I don't want to pay everything yet. You know, I don't want to have to register and do all this. I don't want to have to take all the exams. I kind of want to just sit in and like hear a little bit and get a little bit of a benefit, but I'm not really sure yet, so I don't really want to fully register. So I'll just audit the class. You know, the professor won't really know or won't really, he's not really responsible to grading me or to make sure that I've paid all my dues or things like that to register the class. And there's a difference between when you're auditing class, when you're fully registered, because there's just a cost, there's all these other things, you know, you have to take an evaluation, but you don't get the credit, essentially. And it's interesting that this is what a hearer is. It's like, and it's compared to as if you're auditing a class. And it's interesting that, you know, we can go through life I don't really want to, you know, participate and be counted as one of those part of that class. And there's a lot of us that Jesus cautions us that, hey, if we're a hearer, it's almost equivalent to us wanting to just be an auditor of Christianity. And we can come and audit the faith. And, oh, I'll do it a little bit, I'll get some sort of benefit, but I don't want to fully give my life or do what God has said in his word. And God is cautioning us, and he's saying that, hey, I don't want you to be a hearer of Christianity. I want you to be a doer of Christianity. Amen? We're called to do God's work. We're called to do his word. We're called to be part, engaged. We're supposed to not just sit on the sidelines of and become an auditors where we're saying, you know, as a spectator, just to hear and not really go to attend life group, not really go to, you know, many of us, we approach Christianity that way. We're like, I don't want to give my life. I don't want to serve. I don't want to be part. I don't want to be counted among. I don't want to become a member. It's that. We want to become part, right? And it's like just like a class that we were to audit. I want to hear and I want to come in celebration, but I don't want to give my life. I don't want to take SOM. You know, I don't want to be part of that. Why do we have to take the training? Why do I don't want to serve. Are you hearing me today? Amen. And it's interesting that God is calling us as a church to mature in our faith, that he doesn't want us to be hearers, only hearers of Christianity. He wants us to become doers of the word. You know, it's actually interesting that in the Bible, when we're talking in that verse 22, it says, do not merely listen to the word, so being a hearer of the word, and so deceive yourselves, do what it says. You see, what is interesting there is the word deceive yourself. We're just going to pause there for a second and think about that. Take a look at that. You know that you can actually, the word here is cautioning us that we can actually deceive ourselves when it comes to being a hearer or a doer of God's word. You know what deception is? It's when we're being fooled into believing something that's not the truth. And so you can actually deceive yourself, or you can fool yourself into believing that you're walking in the truth when you're actually not. You know, self-deceit is one of the most subtle and fatal types of deceit. You know, it's because we're convincing ourselves that we've got it when really God's saying we don't. And many times, you know, I'm really challenging you today. I'm pushing your buttons a little. Because God is calling us. We've actually been hearing a lot of heavy words. If you've been at these last, you know, few messages for, you know, I believe my dad was talking about breaking the paradigm, like the church paradigms. It was really, he went straight in there. We were joking with some of the young adults and we said, wow, I think because they're so camp, he didn't have time. He just went straight to the principal and we said, whoa, Lord, that's intense. And we've been receiving a lot of really powerful truth that it would really change the way we lived our lives if we were doing it. And that's why I'm here to talk to you about the message that God is calling us not to just be merely hearers of the word, but doers. You know, it's tempting because we can deceive ourselves. We can think that we've had it all together. We know all the scriptures. We know exactly. Michelle, I've heard James 1, 22 to 25. I can quote it. I can preach it. I can expound it. I can write a blog on it. No, write a blog on it. Then blog about it. For both genders. You know? And yet, let me ask you, are you doing it? God's asking us. In fact, it's so heavy. You know, I'm preaching to myself today because I'm very challenged when God says, Michelle, are you doing my word? When you heard that word last week, are you doing it? It's very challenging.
because he loves us. He wants us to walk in the truth. Look at what James 4:17 says. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. You know how intense this is? That the how much responsibility we carry every single week when we come in and we hear the word. Because the more that we hear the word, the more that we know, and the more that we know when we don't do it, we sin. And so, if I, you know, if it's just me, I don't want to be just a hearer. I want to be a doer, because the more I hear God's word, you know, we can come and, you know, our celebration and say, okay, yeah, I want to listen. I want to see who's the preacher today. Is it Pastor Roy? I want to hear who's the preacher today. And we can be so, you know, who's that? Who, you know, is it, who's the guest speaker? Is there a guest speaker? Who's that? I don't even know who that is. Michelle, who's that? I can see her. I'm Michelle, by the way, if you don't know me. Didn't even introduce myself. Anyways, we can be so caught up in those things, yet God is teaching us, you know, when we come in and we hear God's word, there's an accountability that comes. I wouldn't be concerned about who's preaching or who, you know, who's doing what. I would be concerned about whatever I heard, I need to apply this. Because if I don't, God is keeping me accountable for every single information. I would almost be like, thank you for less information, because I only have one thing that I need to apply today. I'm just making a joke, okay? Of course, we need to know the Word of God, right? That's how we need to study the Word of God and show ourselves approved. But I'm just showing you that being a hearer, coming to the celebration Sunday, being thirsty for knowledge, and yet not being thirsty to be a doer of God's Word, we're deceiving ourselves. Who's doing it? You. And the good thing is that God is so faithful, he's so gracious, and he's so kind, he's waking us up this afternoon. He's saying, come on, church, don't deceive yourselves. I'm calling you to do my word. I'm calling you to live this out. We've been receiving challenging things. You know, in fact, that's why the scripture goes on to talk about that mirror illustration. Where in the mirror he's saying, you know, like, it's like a man who goes in and he looks at himself and then all of a sudden he forgets who he is. It's so foolish. Where we just hear and then we don't even do it. It doesn't make sense. And that's why God is calling us to heed his instruction as a church. That we don't become satisfied or content with information. We don't become satisfied or content without demonstration. And I know we've talked about this a lot, but it's another thing that we need to continue to challenge ourselves to become doers of God's word. You know that with every single word of God that is released, with every time we're praying and we're reading the word of God for ourselves, whenever the word of God is being exhorted, there comes a temptation in our lives, or even not only a temptation, but an option, if we're going to sit on that side of the word to be a hearer of that word or a doer. That when the word of God is released, in that word, am I going to sit with being a hearer of that word or a doer of that word? God is calling us. You know, I know that hearing is important, though. So I don't have anything against hearing, but the Bible says do not merely hear. Don't just hear. Because the Bible talks about how, you know, in Romans 10:17, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. So our faith actually comes from hearing. Our faith is not hearing. Get that? So our faith is built up by our hearing, but it's not our faith when we just hear. Some of us, we think we hear and we're saying, oh wow, I have so much faith because I heard so much. Hearing will build our faith, but our faith is not just hearing. Amen? Tell the person beside you, Be a doer. That's why James follows to say in James 2, verse 17, in the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. There's a doing component. If we think otherwise, we deceive ourselves. And again, I'm talking to you, and I'm telling you, you know, it's not about, not regarding our salvation, that there's a list of things to do. I'm talking about when Jesus comes into our lives, he transforms us, and we begin to do because of who we are. You know, many times we think, oh yeah, I'm here, you know, I receive God, and nothing changes in our lives because we don't think we need to do anything. And God is teaching us that when we receive it in our lives, you know, we're not just supposed to hear his word, it's actually supposed to, hearing his word is actually supposed to build faith, and faith is calling us to action. Our real faith is, actually the Bible says that if there is no action, then our faith is dead. There's a doing part of Christianity. Amen? God calls us to be doers. I want to encourage you today, and when the rest of the passage, James 1:25, it talks about, but whoever intently looks into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. So there's incentive for us to do God's word. There's incentive for us to move from being hearers, but to be doers, because God calls us and he says that those who continue on in it, those who don't just hear God's word, but those who do it, continue in it, they will be blessed in all they do. The word blessed here talks about being in a place where God extends all of his benefits. That's what being blessed is. God extending all of his benefits towards us. So when we continue in God's word, that's when he blesses us. That's when all of these benefits come into our lives. That's in fact why the Bible talks and it says the law of liberty, because doing the word of God, doing the works of God is not something that will kill you because you have a long list of things to do. It's because in doing God's word, there's life. It's in doing God's word, that's when the true blessing comes in our lives, where he extends all of his benefits towards us. It's something that actually sets us free. Remember in John 8, when we continue in the word, then they will know that we're true disciples. And then that's when the truth will set us free. That's when it's a law of liberty. The truth will actually set us free when we continue in his word. Amen? That's when we'll receive the blessing of God, when we move not just from being a hearer, but to be a doer of God's word. That's when we're going to be blessed. Look at Luke 11:28. Jesus said, this is what Jesus talking. He replied, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Even Joshua talks about, you know, the blessing of God that comes from doing God's commands and doing his word. In Joshua 1:8, keep this book of the law always on your lips, meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Amen? We're looking all the time for keys to success. Keys to, you know, maybe we look in the magazines and, you know, online, what's success, how can I do it? And you know, we need to start looking at the Word of God when we do the Word of God. Not just hear the Word of God. Hearing is the first part, but it's inspiring our faith that we do. Amen? His word. And so maybe you're now sitting there and thinking, okay, Michelle, I don't want to just audit Christianity anymore. You know, I don't want to come and just participate and try to get a benefit, but not actually participate fully or commit my life to doing your word. And you're sitting there saying, okay, Michelle, you convinced me to be a doer of God's word. You're shouting there so passionately, jumping, you know. Turning down your mic all the time. And you convinced me, I need to be a doer of God's word. I can see it clearly, not just to be a hearer, but to be a doer. The Bible says not just to hear God's word, but do what it says. And so I'm going to give you just really some key things that will help you to do God's word in your life so that we can move from just being merely hearers to become doers of his word. The first thing is this: do God's word even when you don't understand. If we want to be moved from hearers of God's word to doers of God's word, we must be committed to do God's word even when we don't understand. Let's just remember Abraham's example. You know, when he was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac, I'm sure that in his mind he had every opportunity to question God because he didn't understand. You remember he was the one who was called to be a father of many nations, and Isaac was his only son, and it didn't make sense. Even as if you're reading the story, you would think, whoa, God, hey, don't, how's that going to work out? Because you said that Abraham's going to be the father of many nations, that you're going to bless his offspring, and yet you're asking him to sacrifice Isaac. I don't understand that. But you know, thank God that Abraham was committed to do God's word even when he didn't understand. You know, he could have asked for an explanation. Why, God? You know, human nature is always sometimes tempted to question God for everything. Oh, Lord, why? Why this? Why that? Why should I give my tithes? Why should I put you first? Why should I go to life group? Why do I need to, you know, give my life? Why do I need to attend Sunday celebration? Why do I need to follow this and do that? Why? You know, but the Bible says we can look at Abraham's example, and he was committed to do God's word, even if he didn't understand. The Bible says that early next morning, he saddled his donkey to go. Abraham just did it. He didn't delay. It was even early the next morning. You know, it wasn't afternoon. Okay, wait, God, let me just understand this. He did it right away because he was committed to do God's word, even when he didn't understand. A life of obedience, friends, is one that obeys God's commands without question, without delay. And I'm not saying that you can't offer your lament to God, or you can't express your feelings to God, but what God's calling us to do is to obey, even when we don't understand. You know, that will demonstrate even our love and our trust in God. That's really what trust is, that even when we don't understand, we trust you, God. Because you see the bigger picture. You see, you're Lord of my life, so whatever I've committed to you, I've committed to do your word, no matter what the cost or no matter what situation, even when I can't understand. You know, in our lives, it's either he's Lord or not Lord at all. You say that again. In our lives, it's either he's Lord of all or not Lord at all. There's no in between. Because it's just like a king. When you say he's Lord, you know, he's our Savior, he redeemed us, he saved us. But when you call him a Lord, you received him as Lord, that means everything. He lords over it. He has authority, he has control. You've submitted your life to him, that whatever he says, that you obey, that you do it. You don't question all these things. You don't wait to understand. Many times as Christians, or, you know, that's sometimes what separates us from hearing God's word and doing, is because we want understanding in between. God, if I hear your word, and then when you explain it to me and you show me exactly how it's going to piece together, then I'm going to do it. Most of the time, that's our situation. You know, look at even in our practical things, maybe the last few messages. Oh, God, you know, your word says I need to tithe and to give, you know, bring my offering into the storehouse. And God, but I don't understand how this is going to work out. And, you know, you need to explain how first, where's the money going to come for this, then this, then this, you know, all these things. And then once you show me, Lord, then I will do your word and give my tithes. Come on. Talking to someone? And that's what sometimes separates us from hearing God's word and doing it. Sometimes we just want so much understanding. But our trust in God is that thing that is what enables us to do his word and do his way without understanding. God is calling us to a deeper level of trust, and we need to move if we want to be blessed, extend all of his benefits, if we want to see the miracles of God, if we want to see God organize all that stuff in our lives, we need to do it even if he doesn't understand. That's the same thing with Abraham. Imagine if he asked for the, you know, okay, God, show me the plan first. Show me that you're going to, you know, you're going to put something in replacement of Isaac just before I'm about to kill him. Show me that, and then I'll go to the mountain. Come on. Many times it's us. We're honest. Show me the plan first, Lord, and then I'll obey you. When I understand it, then it'll make sense. Then once it makes sense, then I'll do it. Come on. And many times that's what hinders us from doing God's word. You know, we just hear him say, yeah, we need to do that. We actually don't do it because we want to see, we want to understand every single thing. You know, in addition, I understand that sometimes we're going through trials. We're going through challenges, and some of you, we don't understand why. We don't understand what's going on. And many times, you know, we're saying, God, you know, maybe that's a situation. It's a real situation where, you know, you're in lack. Or, you know, financially you're struggling and you don't understand how you're going to get out of that. And you're thinking, how can I even do your word if all of this is like that? I'm struggling, God. Or maybe it's a situation in your own life. Maybe it's a sickness, you know, or something in your family that you don't understand is happening, a situation, a challenge, something that's going on that you don't completely understand. You're saying, how can I do your word, God? You know, God calls us to do his word even when we don't understand. You know why? Because his way is higher. His thoughts are higher. Look at Isaiah 55, verse 8. That's what God tells us. That we are, you know, that we need to trust him when we're doing his word, because not all the times we understand, look, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. And it's just a testimony, it's an encouragement for us to trust him when we, and to do his word when we don't understand. Because his thoughts are higher, his ways are higher. We need to know that he has a better way. I want to encourage you with this. And before I actually pull up this quote, you know, there's even some situations that I can't explain. God is a sovereign God. I can't explain some things to you. I can't explain maybe why God is the amazing God that he's sovereign. There's some things we won't fully understand because our mind is finite compared to an infinite God. So it won't make sense to us. I can't tell you sometimes, we were listening to our last messages, I can't tell you why God made, you know, has these things in his word. I can't explain every single thing to you. I can't explain to you why he created the stars. I can't explain to you why he created man and female. You know, I can't explain those things. And when we look at the word of God and we see and we say, oh, you know, oh, we're not supposed to gossip and do all this and do all that, and we're supposed to give our tithes. And, you know, I'm just referring to our message last week. So, you know, there's many more examples, but just because last week we heard, or I don't know if it was last week or the weeks before, but we heard about those things, even with same-sex marriage and homosexuality. I can't sometimes explain to you exactly why he created male and female and said all these things. He's a sovereign God. And he created it that way. But I have to trust that his thoughts and his ways are higher, and I have to be committed to do his word, even when we don't understand. And because he's sovereign. You know, we can obey Christ without question and choose to do God's word, even when we don't understand. Look at this quote. It's by Rick Warren in The Purpose-Driven Life. God doesn't owe you an explanation or reason for everything he asks you to do. Understanding can wait, but obedience can't. Instant obedience will teach you more about God than a lifetime of Bible discussions. In fact, you will never understand some of his commands until you obey them first. Obedience unlocks understanding. I'm sure many of you who obeyed God's word before can testify to that. There's sometimes moments where you didn't understand what's happening, but the moment you obeyed, then you started to understand and see God's purpose and see God's promise. And so if we're going to move from hearer to doer of God's word, we need to be committed to do his word even when we don't understand. Second thing is this, do God's word even when it's not comfortable. Matthew 14, 28 to 29, this talks about Peter. When we look at his example, Peter obeyed and did God's word when he got out of the boat and walked on water. Look at Matthew 14, 28 to 29. Lord, if it is you, Peter replied, tell me to come out, to come to you on the water. 29, come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on water, and came towards Jesus. Of course, we know the rest of the story. There was a time when Peter failed, but at the very beginning, when he just committed to do God's word, he got out of the comfort of his boat. You know, you may have heard like several sermon series about getting out of the boat of comfort. But, you know, it wasn't comfortable for him to go out into a place where there's no, you know, real tangible thing that it makes sense. And Peter got out of his boat, and out of his comfort, he started to walk on water because he just did what God said, even when it wasn't comfortable. And friends, that's the same thing. If we're going to, we want to see the power and the manifestation of God's, you know, miracle working power in our lives, we've got to be committed from not just hearing about God's word, but doing God's word, that when he says to get out of our comfort zone, when he says, do this, when he says, oh, go pray for this person, we do it. Or go visit that person in the hospital, our relative. We go do it and we pray for them. Or when we share with a person in grief, or when we evangelize them and share our testimony and the word about Christ. It's not comfortable. Maybe, you know, how many of you sometimes it's a difficult thing that it's not comfortable to do those things. I'm sure if it was really easy and comfortable that this whole place would be filled. But God calls us to do his word even when it's not comfortable, that we're not just hearers, but we're doers of God's word. That's when we're going to see a manifestation of God's power in our lives. When we're committed to do his word. You know, when we don't just hear about the miracles of God, but we become doers. And we experience it in our lives because we're committed that even when it's not comfortable. You know, it might not be comfortable to stand for truth in the moment in your school or in your job, your workplace, sometimes even in church circles. You know, it's very difficult. We were talking about gossip last week, and it's a very tough thing to start doing the word of God. It's not comfortable. Come on. You try to be the one who stops gossip in that moment. Trust me, it's not easy. It's not comfortable. And it's tough to do the word of God, but we must be willing to do God's word, not just hear about it and say, wow, 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 Pastor Jerry, Pastor Albie, you know, or, you know, Pastor Roy, Pastor Michelle, that's a good word, and not do it. Sometimes it's going to take us from a hearer to a doer, is to get out of our comfort zone and do it. It's to do God's word even if it's not comfortable. You know, there's even, especially in our time, there's a lot of things that society is going with the flow, and it's not going to be comfortable to stand for the truth of the word of God. You must be prepared to do God's word even when it's not comfortable. The last thing is this. We need to be prepared to do God's word. We want to be a doer of his word. Do God's word even when it might be costly. We should be committed to do his word even if it costs us something. Jesus can be our greatest example. Philippians 2, verses 5, and then we'll look at verse 8. Verse 5 says this, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Then verse 8, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. See, friends, Jesus is an example that he was committed to do God's word and his will, no matter what it cost him. That in his moment of nearing his death, he said, not my will, but your will be done. He became obedient to even death on a cross. When God asked him to do that for us, he was obedient, thank God. And it cost Jesus his life, even his own will that time. talking about really, really practically just those messages before. For example, you know, maybe I want to talk about all this stuff. That's my desire. I love talking. It's going to cost us not to talk, to do God's word. Or, oh, I love to buy this and buy this and buy this. It's going to cost us maybe to do God's word and start giving our tithes, aligning our life. Cost us maybe those things that we want to buy because we want to be obedient. Or it's going to cost us maybe our desire. What if there's some things that there's a relationship that God said is not right? And it costs us our desire or our will because we want that. We want that relationship. We want it that way. But God's way says something else. It's going to cost me my desire. Jesus, it cost him his will. He said, not my will, but your will. Because he trusts God. Amen? And if we want to move from being a hearer of God's word and all these nice principles of God, you know, all these challenging, to not just hearing it, but doing it, it's going to cost us something. You know, but I want to encourage and challenge you today that God wants us to advance this year. He wants us to advance and not remain hearers only, not merely hearers. He wants us to hear first, but he wants us to do his word. He wants to make it real in your life. He wants us to be a doer, not to be an auditor of Christianity. Where we hear and we participate to an extent, but we don't want to do the cost. We don't want the commitment. We don't want all that other stuff. I just want to get some sort of benefit and kind of associate myself in this thing of Christianity and following Jesus. Come on. God wants us to advance and say, come on, who's going to be a doer of my word? Who's going to do Christianity? Who's going to hear it? Have faith, but do it, that things start changing and aligning in their lives. Not because they have to have a list of things to do to attain God, to earn something from God. No, because when he's called them, when he's taken over their life, that it changes who I am, that it commands me presently to continue in his word, because it's the law of liberty. It's the thing that gives me life. It's the thing that sets me free. It's the thing that brings blessing, that is, all of his benefits are mine because I've chosen to do God's word. Amen. Friends, I'm encouraging you today, I'm challenging you today that we become doers of God's word. Let me really encourage you with this. You know, even Jesus said, John 4:34, really quickly, my food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Even Matthew 7:21 says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. You know, I'm going to talk with you very, very real in this moment. A lot of times, I know even Pastor Roy is really good at challenging us in our congregations to be real before God. Because God sees where we're at in our walk with him. And many times, you know, I love that he always gives us an opportunity to really be real with God. And, you know, sometimes he often gives us a call and says, you know, if you're not there yet, you know, you know, you're questioning your faith, you're not sure, come now, do it now, be sure now, and receive Jesus in your life. So thankful for, you know, him and how he's asked. He always gives us an opportunity to acknowledge God. But I want to challenge you. You know, a lot of times, that many of us keep having to do that. Because there's a conviction, a real conviction in our heart. It's not that we weren't genuine in those moments, right? Because how many of you, if that's happened to you before, you were really genuine, you really committed your life, you really said, God, this time it really, you know, sincere. But why is there a conviction again? It's because many times we've heard it and we've received it, and we don't do it. We don't do God's word. We don't do his will. We don't, and that's why, again, no matter, there's still that conviction the next time because I'm not doing God's work. I'm not doing His word in my life. That's why there's still a conviction. Because the difference is that it's not that we weren't sincere. It's that we know that we're not living a life that's doing God's work. And that's a challenge for us today. You know, I would encourage you to take that seriously. Take it seriously that God, this time, I want to do it your way. I want to do your word. I don't want to just hear your word. I want it to transform my life. And it becomes such a real thing. I'm going to leave you with one last verse to, you know, give you some good news. Is that in Philippians 2:13, the NLT version says, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire to obey Him and the power to do what pleases Him." I would encourage you that God doesn't leave you alone to do His word. He empowers us. He puts a desire in us. That's why many of you sometimes are convicted right now. God, I want to do it your way. Because He's putting in us, you know, Holy Spirit's the one convicting us, leading us to become more like Him and to do His word. And God actually enables us, so it's not impossible. You know, of course, many times we fail, but God wants us to commit to doing His way. Why? Because remember what we said before, that's when we'll be blessed in all we do. There's an incentive for us. And if we want to even walk in a life of blessing, if we want God to extend His benefits to us, that's what we'll be prosperous and successful if we do in His will. Like we'll walk in the law of His life. You know, even in Psalms 119, it shows how lovely the Word of God is. It's not this thing that we have to keep doing this list and until we check up every box that we're not, you know, we can't do it. That's not what I'm talking about. God is even enables us to do His work. So I want to encourage you and challenge you today that, you know, we move not just we move from just being a hearer to being a doer of God's word. Sometimes we need to, and to encourage you, we need to commit to do that by really doing God's word, even if we don't understand. Whatever circumstance, whatever thing you're going through, you know, whatever situation in your life, even you have to trust that God's thoughts, His ways are higher. You've got to commit to do God's word, even when it's not comfortable. If we want to see the breakthrough, if, you know, it's not comfortable to stand for truth and righteousness. But if we do God's word, that's the only time we're going to see things start to change in our lives and around the people around us. And when we do God's word, sometimes it will really cost us a lot. But the promise is that we'll be blessed in everything we do. Amen? Mm-hmm. And God empowers us to do His will, to do His word. Jesus is even our greatest example. Amen? Let's just pray, and I'm going to call the worship team. Father God, we just thank You for the truth of Your word. Holy Spirit, I thank You that You're speaking to us right now, that You're calling us to action. You're calling us to commit to doing Your word, no matter what the situation looks like, to be true followers of You. Lord, we honor You and we thank You for teaching us and guiding us, because You love us so much that You bring discipline to those You love. So we say, have Your way in our midst, Lord. Speak to Your people now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we have the worship team come, you know, and lead us into a time of worship, I want to